A very good morning, everyone. Today we'll be studying the second part of our unit 6, that is farm planning and budgeting. And in this we will be studying a budgeting technique and the third budgeting technique, that is linear programming. It is quite mathematical and the most sophisticated technique that a farmer can use for choosing what enterprise he should follow, in what quantity, which enterprise he should follow. Let's study. We have completed this part. Completed two types of budgeting, partial budgeting and complete budgeting. Now we will be going through linear programming up to its what is linear programming, assumptions, what are the concepts related to it, and how do we find the optimum, that is the best solution according to the limitations of the farmer, okay, and the limitations of this programming technique. What is linear programming and how did it come to into being? Okay, it was discovered by this guy George Danzig in 1947 when he was working to found the optimal transport of ammunition quickly with the minimum cost, okay, from different transportation different depots. He had to transport ammunition to different places. What should be the plan, how he should conduct this activity, that this cost comes out to be minimum, okay? So he used this technique that was later on called as linear programming. What is its definition? It is mathematical methods of analysis which finds the best combination of activities to meet a certain objective. So it is quite a general definition. In farming, our objective is generally to maximize profits. So it is a mathematical technique or mathematical methods of analysis which by using which we can find the best set of crop enterprises or activities a farmer should follow to get maximum profits. Okay, three things are needed for this. First one is objective, either to maximize profits, it can be to maximize profits or to minimize costs. Okay, so these two objectives, either of them will be our objective of the study. Then objective function, it will be an equation which I'll be showing you later on, which shows a set of activities. This objective function needs to be either minimized or maximized. Okay, so this function shows either the returns or the cost. Let's say for an example, maximize this function, maximize z, which is 10,000 into paddy wheat area, this is the area under wheat, plus 20,000 into area under mustard. So this problem says 10,000 rupees returns comes from per acre of wheat and 20,000 rupees returns come from per acre of mustard. So what combination of these crops according to his constraints, you know, these constraints are very important. According to his constraint, what area of paddy and what area of mustard he should be cultivating so that he gets maximum profits. So third thing we need is constraints. Now, every farmer has some constraints according to his own situation. Let's learn these things with some examples. But first, we will be studying some assumptions of linear programming which need to be kept in mind before employing this technique. What are the assumptions? Wait a second, please. Proportionality or linearity. That means it's simple. There is a linear relationship between activity and response, means output and input. 1 acre of wheat will need 60 kg of nitrogen, so 2 acres of wheat will require 120 kg of nitrogen. That means there is a linear relationship, there is not a quadratic or can say a square root kind of a relationship or cubic relationship. It remains linear. Even if it is 200 acres, it will be 12,000 kilogram of nitrogen. Okay, additivity, total resources used by several enterprises equal to the sum. Let's say 1 acre of wheat requires 60 kg of nitrogen and 1 acre of paddy will require 120 kg of nitrogen. So total requirement will be 180. That's all. It's simple. So there is no carry forward. let's say use 60 kt of nitrogen in the field, and in the next paddy season you are using only 110 kg, and you think that 10 kg of nitrogen will be remaining in the field because I used 60 kg, it might have leached out and paddy crop might use it. So this is not the case. You just simply add the total resource count by summing up the resources used by individual enterprises. Divisibility. Resources and products are infinitely divisible. Our inputs and output quantity is infinitely divisible. That means, let's say 1 acre of wheat will give you 21 quintals of yield. So 0.1 acre will give you 2.1 quintals of yield. So this is, you have divided it by 10, and so similarly it divides itself by the 10. So there is a linear relationship, plus you can divide inputs. We have divided input, that is land, and we have divided output, that is the product. Non-negativity. Output and input cannot be negative, which is very simple. The quantity of labor, quantity of output, quantity of seed, anything, it can never be negative. Never. Understood? Finiteness. Number of activities and constraints are finite. Then we should not be focusing on innumerable activities. We should be focusing on 2, 3, 4, 5, these kind of, this much of activities, not more than that. But we should not be focusing on, the constraints should also be few in numbers, let's say 2, 3, 4, 5. It should not be like 10, 20, 30 or maybe more. So these problems become big. Certainty. Everything should be known with certainty. These requirements, the yields, the input quantity, the output quantity, everything should be known with certainty. There should not be any ambiguity, okay? There should not be any kind of double ambiguity. I'll say double, you are having two things in mind. Either this will happen or that will happen. It should not be the case. These concepts will be discussed later on as I tell you about the, we will discuss a problem and then we'll, what is a solution, what is a feasible, infeasible, optimal and unbounded solution. This, remember, optimal means the best possible solution that maximizes our objective function. This is used for objective function, which can be for maximizing profits, as I told you earlier, or minimizing cost. So let's go to the example. Finding an optimal solution, there are two methods. One is a tabular method and another is a graphical method. And also the graphical methods are of two types. So let's go through them one by one. See, we have two options, paddy and groundnut. 1 acre of paddy gives us 15,000 net income after deducting expenses. 1 acre of groundnut gives us 14,000 rupees of income. Alright, so we are trying to decide, we are trying to maximize our net revenue, means maximize our profits. So we are trying to decide how many acres of paddy and how many acres of groundnut should we cultivate so that our revenue is maximum. Alright, 15,000 into area of paddy, 14,000 into area of groundnut. Okay, so what are the constraints we are facing? We have three constraints here. Land is limited, we have only 4 acres. Labor is limited, we have 2250 hours. Cash is limited, we have only 35,000 rupees of cash. Per acre requirement of paddy is land, per acre requirement is 1 acre. Per acre requirement of labor is 450 hours of labor. Per acre requirement of cash for buying different inputs is 11,000. Similarly, for groundnut it is 600 hours of labor, 6,000 rupees of cash. So maximum amount of paddy that can be cultivated using these resources entirely in paddy is, let's say, 4 acres of paddy can be cultivated if we just use all the land for paddy. How many acres of paddy can be cultivated if we use all the labor in paddy? 450, 2250 divided by 450. It comes out to be, we can cultivate 5 acres of land. Okay, if we use this entire amount of 35,000 for paddy, we can cultivate 3.18 acres of paddy. Alright, Similarly, for groundnut, if we use all these resources only for groundnut, then we can cultivate 4 acres of 4 acres of groundnut according to the land constraint. According to the labor constraint, we can cultivate 3.75, that is 2250 divided by 600, comes out to be 3.75 acres, and 35,000 divided by 6,000, it comes out to be 5.83 acres of groundnut. So we have got these figures now. So what we will be doing now is we will be making constraint equation. This is objective function equation, where PA is the area under paddy, GA is the area under groundnut. So let's make constraint equations. We have a constraint that we need minimum area of paddy of 0.70 acre. This is our requirement. This might be because we need fodder for our livestock. Okay, the paddy stubble will be used as fodder. So this is our requirement. This is our constraint, that at least I need paddy area of 0.70 acres. Okay, then the labor. Let's say the land constraint. How do we write this land constraint in terms of equation? Paddy area plus groundnut area should always be less than 4, because the maximum quantity of land available is 4 acres. Okay, the cash constraint, 11,000 into paddy area, 11,000 into paddy area plus 6,000 into groundnut area should be less than, that means the total requirement of paddy and groundnut should be less than 35,000, because this much is the cash available. Okay, if this is 0, then entire as we know, if this is 0, then groundnut area that can be cultivated, groundnut area 35,000 divided by 6,000 would be 5.83. So the third constraint for labor is 450 hours of labor is required in 1 acre of paddy, 600 hours of labor is required in area of groundnut, and the total requirement should be less than 2250, because this is the maximum amount of labor available with us. Okay, now let's plot these lines on a graph. How are we going to plot these things? We found out the maximum quantity that we can cultivate if we use all the resources either in paddy or in groundnut. We will plot these on x-axis and these points on y-axis. Okay, so this will make one line for land constraint, this will make second line for labor constraint, this will make third line for cash constraint. Let's see, we'll plot them. This will also be plotted. So this is minimum paddy area constraint, that paddy area should be greater than 0.70. Okay, cash constraint line, 5.83 on y-axis and 3.18 on x-axis. As I told you, 3.18 on x-axis and 5.83 on y-axis. Join this line, cash constraint. Similarly, 4, this was area constraint. As you can see, area constraint, paddy area plus groundnut area should be less than equal to 4. Labor constraint, again 5 and 3.75. Just join these lines, you will get a labor constraint. By looking at these signs, labor also has this less than equal to sign, cash also has this less than equal to sign, we will be trying to find a feasible region. We have plotted all the 4 lines now, all the constraint lines. We have plotted 4. Now how to find a feasible region, that where the solution lies? We will be looking at these signs now. So this sign less than equal to indicates that we should be looking towards inwards. Okay, inwards. But this greater than equal to sign shows we should be moving outwards. So the common area of all the 4 lines comes out to be this area, which has coordinates A, B, C, D and E. This is a feasible region where our solution for the problem lies. Okay, optimal solution. Now we have found out the feasible region. Where does the optimal solution lies? In the feasible region, solutions are there. Okay, we can plot any, we can use any combination of the area under paddy and wheat. This is the area under paddy and this is the groundnut. Okay, we can use any point inside or on the boundaries which will give us a solution for our problem. We will be able to cultivate different quantities of land under paddy and groundnut in any of the combination, either inside or on them, but we have to find a solution which is giving us maximum profit. So what do we do to find the optimal solution in this region A, B, C, D, E? What do we do? What we do is we take these points 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 A, B, C, D, E and write down their coordinates. Coordinates of this one, point A was 0.7 and groundnut area is 0. Okay, so we have written down the coordinates. Wait a second, please. We have written down the coordinates of all of them. What we are going to do, this is PA and this is GA. What we are going to do, we are going to put all the coordinates of the feasible region inside the objective function. This is the objective function equation and find the value of Z, that means net return or profit. As we put 0.70 and 0 here, we get 10,500. Just substitute PA, substitute these points and these points for GA and find different 5 different solutions. We have 5 sets of coordinates, so we are going to get 5 values of Z. Okay, so that the maximum value we get is for D combination, that is 2.2 acres of paddy and 1.8 acre of groundnut. How much is the value? Our profit is maximum here, that is 58,200. 2.2 acres of paddy and 1.8 acre of groundnut. Okay, so how much land did we use? We used 4 acres of land. How much labor did we use? 2.2 into, let's see what was the requirement of labor, was 450 here, 600 here. 2.2 into 450 plus 1.8 into 600 comes out to be 2070 hours of labor. So this much of labor was used and some amount of labor, 2250 minus 2070, 180 hours of labor was remaining. Okay, it was not used, but still we earned the maximum amount of money. So you can understand, see, with the limited resources we are earning maximum amount of money. Okay, so this much amount of labor was used and total amount of cash was used in this combination. So this is how we found the best possible solution. Okay, the optimal solution is one of the feasible solutions. Okay, so there is one more method. This was, first we made a table, we plotted lines and again we made a table, then we found the solution. But there is another method, direct method of finding the solution. We made a table, okay, we found the we plotted these lines of constraint lines, made table, plot constraint lines, then plot objective function line. How do we plot this objective function line? We are going to plot this ISO revenue line, which is also called as objective function line. ISO revenue line means, ISO means same revenue on all points lying on this line. How do we plot it? We are going to plot it by finding its slope. Slope is found out by the revenue line was 50, objective function was 15,000 PA plus 14,000 GA. What we do was, this divided by this is 1.071. We are going to plot a line of slope 1.071. This is an objective function line. So we plotted an objective function line with slope 1.071. Slope is generally the, let's say OA by OB, the length of line on the y-axis plus the length of the line on the x-axis gives us the slope. So what happens now? So what we know is isorevenue line, if it is close to the origin, that means less revenue. If it is far from the origin, that means higher revenue. Okay, this is the property of isorevenue line. The farmer wants maximum revenue, that's why isorevenue line should be as far as origin from the as far from the origin as possible, but within the feasible region. So what we do is we plot this line. It was, let's say, earlier plotted here. What we started moving this line further as long as it was lying inside this feasible region. We kept on moving, and the farthest point of the feasible region it touched was D point. D was a feasible solution to our problem, and in this case it is the optimal or the best solution. D was the farthest point where it was still in the feasible region. Okay, that means it was satisfying all our constraints, and we can follow that combination of enterprises. This much of area of paddy and this much of 1.8 acres of groundnut and 2.2 acres of paddy. It was still possible to do follow that combination. So what happened was we plotted this line, we kept on moving it further until it was in the feasible region, and we tried to find the farthest point of the feasible region where the isorevenue line was there, still there in the feasible region. So we drew the isorevenue line with the slope 1.071, moved it away from the origin, and the farthest point it touched was D, which came out to be the optimal solution. Okay, farther mean more revenue. Alright, so this was the second method of finding the graphical solution of a linear programming problem. Now there are certain limitations of following this technique because there is too much maths for a farmer. Not many people with having limited resources, limited knowledge, they cannot follow this technique. Even successful farmers, large farmers, they do not like to follow such techniques. Does not make into account the time. And what does it mean? What it means is with time there are certain changes in our constraints. Okay, the prices of different things, the availability of labor, it does change with time, so it cannot take into account such typical problems. In real world, the relationships are non-linear, but it only solves linear problems. Non-linear, let's say 1 kg of urea, if you add into your field, it will be adding, let's say, 20 kg of wheat. If you add second kg of urea, it might add 22 kg of wheat to your total yield. Third kg, it might reduce to 15 kg of wheat production. So there are non-linear relationships in agriculture, in most of the agricultural problems. So it is very difficult to apply this linear programming technique to these non-linear problems. It is very difficult to apply for macro problems, as I just showed you three constraints and two crops. What if the number of constraints is too much, too many, and the number of options are too many? This makes the process very complex, and this naturally will make the process very complex. That's why people tend not to use such sophisticated techniques in the farm management. So this was all about, one thing was remaining. Now I hope you will understand those concepts. What is a solution? Solution means all the points lying in the feasible region. That the points mean the points will be x and y values, these values lying in the feasible region, which give a positive value to the objective function. That is a solution. All the points lying inside the feasible region will ultimately give you a solution to the objective function with respect to all the constraints. Understood? feasible solution, any solution to a linear programming problem is said to be feasible when none of the xj's is negative. The values that a, b, c, d, e, all these values didn't have any of the coordinates was not negative. Okay, and if the coordinates was not negative, the value of z cannot be negative. Infeasible solution, it refers to a solution where some of the variables appear to be at negative level, or let's leave this point because it is a little typical for your standard right now. The optimal solution, or it was the best possible, the set of xj's, that is the point d in our case, it satisfied all the constraints, plus it maximized our objective function, that is it maximized our profits, all right, which was around 58,200. Unbounded solution, open feasible region. Herein we saw a feasible region because of all the constraints. There was a feasible region with us because most of the lines indicated inside movement. We are supposed to look inside, and this only line indicated an outside movement. Let's say we could not find this was the paddy area constraint. This was the labor constraint. This was a greater than 0 sign in paddy area, 0.70. We are supposed to look outer. Let's say this labor constraint also had a greater than equal to sign. So we were supposed to look out, and there was no feasible region. There was no bounded region where we could find coordinates and put those coordinates into Z and find a maximum value. If we kept on moving our objective function line further and further, the revenue would have increased further, and there was no particular end to it. So that was an unbounded solution because the region was unbounded. So I hope you understand the concepts now. Solution, all sets of activities or all sets of points that were there inside the feasible region which satisfied all the constraints inside as well as on the boundaries. Okay. Same goes with the feasible solution. None of the xj's were negative. Optimal solution, best of all those A, B, C, D, E, best of all the feasible solutions. And unbounded, in case we are not able to find a bounded region with finite boundaries. Alright. So this was all about the second part of your unit 6. Thank you. You can refer to this chapter for further information, but I hope you will not be requiring any further information if you go through this video once or twice as per your requirements. So thank you very much. We'll be meeting in the next unit.